many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you known. Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
Let's go ahead and stand and let's worship the Lord.
The day that brings with the to me. Your love is wide and your promise true. You are so good to me. Your heart is kind in all you do. You are so good to me. How perfect are your ways? How endless is your grace? Forever I will sing your praise. You are so good to me. When blessings come or when life brings pain, you are so good to me. When shadows fall and seasons change, you are so good to me. How perfect are your ways? How endless is your grace? Forever I will sing your praise. You are so good to me. On heaven's shore you will call my name. You are so good to me. A thousand tongues of angels say, you are so good to me. How perfect are your ways? How endless is your grace? Forever I will sing your grace. Forever I will sing your praise. You are so good to me. You are so good to me.
May be seated.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin-dressed sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than worldly applause. I'd rather be faithful to hear his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. Yes, I'd rather be true to to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungry spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Yes, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Carried a burden, not for, sorry, this is a new song, so. I carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again, again and again. Oh, oh, oh. Saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have a contest for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. Run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, My soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again, again and again. Oh, 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 oh. Run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again, again and again. Oh, 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 oh. I run to the Father. Oh, 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 again and again. No only son, no sin to hide. But you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty side and to become the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he died. The humble king they named a fraud. Sacrifice the Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the whole. Precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. I was so lost, I should have died, but you have brought me to your side to be led by your staff and rod and to be called a Lamb of God. O Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in his precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. My Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God.
Thank you, Lenny. Bless your heart. Joy to see you this morning on this, moving along through April, Sunday. A little overcast, but listen, the Lord's here, right? Amen. Joy to have you. And our guests, wonderful to have you today. And there's some information as you leave, if we get some information about you and prayer requests, so forth. Speaking of prayer, we're going to resume our hour of power tonight at 5 o'clock, one of the most important times of the week for us as we lift up the needs of the church, your needs, America, Israel. And it's just about an hour, and we meet around 5 o'clock, have a little time of interaction and fellowship, and then get into prayer. It's really a backbone of our fellowship. So if you have a heart for prayer, or if you have prayer requests, come, and we'll intercede. My wife today is helping out with the children's ministry, and she's a wonderful servant, and we have great servants in the church. but we have open opportunities for children's workers. So if you are you interested in that, pray about that and see Karen, and she'll give you an application and give you some material. We're not going to just send you to the lions right off the bat. We'll children are not really lions, but they can be ferocious at times, though. We have a wonderful children's ministry, and so if that's something that you're interested in, then let us know, and we'll give you the information on that. We're going to continue to take our virtual tour through the nation of Israel. This Wednesday, we've got three more Wednesdays before we get into the book of Job. We're right in between the book of Esther and the book of Job as we march through the Old Testament chapter by chapter on Wednesday evenings. But we've taken a little detour from that study, and we're taking this tour of Israel. Some of you have always wanted to go to Israel, and you haven't been able to go, so this is a cheaper way to go to Israel. And we've done an aerial view of the nation of Israel from north to south, and covered a lot of territory there, and now we're coming down and executing some of the individual geographic locations with on-site Bible studies from Pastor Chuck Smith and others, showing some slides and pictures of when we have been to Israel. So join us on Wednesday nights. It's a wonderful time of fellowship. And in fact, we like to say that Calvary Chapel is the place to be on Wednesday nights. Eric, you can say amen to that, right? Have a brief time of worship and then get right into the study, or in this case, the virtual tour. Please let us have your updated emails. That's the way we've communicated. We don't have a bulletin yet. We're still sending out email bulletins. So if you want to keep up with what's going on, then make sure we have your email addresses. And there's a table back there with, I think there's a sheet back there that you can fill that out with your current email address. Pray for family, friends, neighbors, and then invite them to church. You know, since COVID, they said that church attendance is down by a third, that a third of the people stopped going, and they have not come back. And that's not good. We're praying for spiritual renewal and revival and awakening, and it helps when Christians are together to do that. So pray about that. Reach out to your family, friends, maybe some people you haven't seen for a while, and invite them to Calvary Chapel. I mean, invite them to some church anyway. We're not the only church in town, of course. There's a lot of wonderful churches that lift up Jesus and proclaim the word. But we just want to be faithful to what God has called us to do here. We've been going through the book of Revelation, and so we're back in Revelation. We took a little hiatus for the past couple of weeks. 2 weeks ago, if you recall, we had a great man in this pulpit, Dr. Erwin Lutzer, pastor emeritus at Moody Church. What a blessing he was. He was with us for our Bible prophecy conference that weekend, and just a wonderful weekend, and he's such a gifted communicator. And he addressed his book on Saturday night on "We Shall Not Be Silenced." In fact, I'm going to quote from this at the end of my message today. And then he spoke on how we're going to be judged when we stand before the judgment seat of God as Christians. Not as non-Christians, but as Christians. Did you know that you're going to be judged? Not for salvation, because you've already got your salvation by that time, but how we've lived our Christian life, how we've served the Lord in the power of His Spirit. We're going to be rewarded on the basis of that. I'd like to think maybe some of you are going to get rewards for showing up to Calvary Chapel once in a while. That's worth coming to church, isn't it? Just to know that you're going to get a reward. Serving the Lord with, you know, just His love and grace is so important. And then last week, just a wonderful resurrection celebration. We still have the sign up here on Christ has risen and are redeemed. Probably change those out this week. But the resurrection goes on and on, doesn't it, in the believer's life? Well, let's get into the book of Revelation, chapter 17. Revelation, chapter 17. The fall of Babylon has previously been announced as we've been going through the book of Revelation in Revelation chapter 14, verse 8, and also the final bowl, the seventh bowl that we covered the last time we were together in chapter 16, verse 19. So this Babylon that we're going to define and describe today is headed for doom. The details of its destruction are in Revelation chapter 17 and 18. Though these two chapters overlap somewhat, the focus of chapter 17 is on the destruction of ecclesiastical or religious Babylon, or maybe you've heard it more in a contemporary phrase, the world religion. And in the end, there's going to be a one-world religion, a one-world government, and a one-world economic system. And we see the unfolding of this as I speak. So this false religious system is identified as a harlot in chapter 17. And in chapter 18, the focus is on the economic commercial aspect of Babylon. So chapter 17, the religious ecclesiastical aspect, chapter 18, the commercial and economic aspect of Babylon. Well, let me read verses 1 through 6 of chapter 17 this morning. And one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and spoke with me, saying, "Come here, and I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed acts of immorality, and those who dwell upon the earth were made to drink the wine of her immorality. And he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast full of blasphemous names, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was clothed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a gold cup full of abominations of the unclean things of her immorality. And upon her forehead a name was written, a mystery: Babylon, the great mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the witnesses of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered greatly." Father, we just ask that you open this up to us. Help us to understand your word this morning. Help us to be discerning. Lord, you told us, Matthew chapter 24, three times, "Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived." And you warned us that deception was coming in the latter days. And you've given us a heads up of what's happening in our world today. Your word is teaching us to be discerning so that we can apply your word to our lives, so we can draw close to you, so that we can represent you, communicate your love and grace to our loved ones, to our neighbors, to our co-workers, fellow students, while we have time. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Well, Arnold Fruchtenbaum, who is a Hebrew Bible scholar, a very, very intelligent man, I've seen him speak a few times, he says that the global church is predicted in the last days. It's too early to describe exactly how it's going to form and come about, but we get an idea through this chapter and other chapters, of course, in the Bible. But certainly the ecumenical movement, which is made up of Protestants, Catholics, Eastern Orthodox, and many other religious organizations, could very well be a part of that. And it will expand in the tribulation to include all aspects of religion. And so this is what we're moving towards, and it's really, really exciting to see the unfolding of these things. Even though Revelation chapter 17 hasn't been fulfilled yet, we're seeing the groundwork, the preparation for the fulfillment of these things that we're going to be teaching on this morning. Chapter 17, a few observations on the religious aspect of Babylon. Babylon actually is mentioned over 280 times in the Bible. Now, Revelation has 404 verses, and of those 404 verses, 44 of those verses specifically speak of Babylon. About 11% of Revelation deals with Babylon. Jerusalem is the most often mentioned city in the Bible. It's named about 800 times. And the second most mentioned city is Babylon. Jerusalem means city of peace. Babylon means city of confusion and war. Jerusalem is portrayed as God's city in Revelation chapter 21. Babylon is portrayed as a demonic city in chapter 18, verse 2. Well, I slipped in chapter 18. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I want to focus on chapter 17, but it's kind of hard to separate 17 from 18 because there's such an overlapping with Babylon in both chapters. Jerusalem is portrayed as God's city, and Babylon, of course, is a Satan's city. Revelation describes the New Jerusalem as a chaste bride in Revelation chapter 21, and the New Babylon is described as a great prostitute, as we'll see this morning. Now, today I'd like to give you the description of this religious Babylon in verses 1 through 6 that we just read. Next week, we want to interpret that description in the rest of the chapter, beginning with verse 7. But let's focus on the description of the religious aspect of Babylon here. Verse 1, if you turn to your Bibles again. Verse 1 says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and spoke with me, saying, 'Come here, and I will show you the judgment of the great prostitute who sits on many waters.'" So Revelation is written in chronological order. However, there are chapters that interrupt the flow of the chronology to fill in details. Such is the case with chapter 17 and 18. It fills in some details that, at least in chapter 17, take place at the beginning of the tribulation. So this religious aspect of Babylon really is set in the first part of the tribulation, the first 3.5 years. Chapter 7 depicts a scene from this prostitute image. It focuses on the religious aspect. 1 through 6 is the description, and 7 through 18 is the interpretation. So anyway, verse 1 describes a great prostitute, a harlot, and prostitution is a common metaphor in the Old Testament for unfaithfulness to God. It's not talking about a literal prostitute. Revelation is full of signs and symbols. And the good thing is, as you read on, it usually interprets itself. So we're not left to get conjecture or guessing. That's one of the reasons why a lot of people stay out of the book of Revelation, because they see all these signs and symbols and they can't understand them. It doesn't make sense. But the basic interpretive rule is the Bible interprets itself. And most all these signs and symbols are interpreted in the context of the passage or someplace else in the scripture. So we don't have to wander off and guess. In the Old Testament, we see Jeremiah, Ezekiel especially, describes Israel as a harlot because they've been unfaithful to their God who loved them and who raised them up, who established the nation, and they departed from being faithful to him to other gods, and it's like they were prostituting themselves. Prophecy scholar Mark Hitchcock, who we've had speak here in the past, suggests it's probably a kind of a religious amalgamation or world church that will put together people of various religious backgrounds into one great ecclesiastical alliance after the disappearance of the true church at the rapture. So, one thing that God doesn't like is religion. Because Christianity is not so much a religion as it is a relationship with Jesus Christ. With God the Father through Jesus Christ. And it's important that we understand that there are thousands of religions in the world. And religion is really man's attempt to establish something to reach God. Whereas true biblical Christianity is God reaching out to man to have a relationship with him. And so that's so important. And so we don't want to be religious. We want to be just right with God through that personal relationship with him. And if you don't have that personal relationship, because as we shared last week, the Easter celebration, the resurrection wouldn't have happened if Jesus hadn't died on the cross. And on the cross, he bore our sins, purchased a pardon for life and forgiveness, and he authenticated everything that he said in the Word by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That assures us of eternal life, and also assures us that his Word is true and accurate. So if we believe in his death, his burial, his resurrection, and we trust our life to him, we can be part of God's forever family. You say, it can't be that simple. Jesus made it very simple. He made it so simple that a child can understand it. And yet there's some complexities in the word that scholars are still studying and trying to figure out what he meant. So, but the main thing, he made it so simple for us to come to know the Lord. Verse 17, the second part, says, she sets on many waters. And it's interpreted for us later on in verse 15, the many waters, verse 15 says, and he said to me, the waters which you saw where the prostitute sets are peoples and multitudes and nations and languages. In other words, this woman, this harlot, is influencing the masses of humanity throughout the world in this global false religion. So we see her position, but then we also see her prostitution in verses 2 through 3. Let's take that one verse at a time. Verse 2. With whom the kings of the earth committed acts of sexual immorality, and those who live upon the earth became drunk with the wine of her passion. Sexual immorality, different translations translate passion or immorality. So religion can be alluring, seductive, and addictive, as we've seen throughout history. And the leaders of the world, the earth dwellers, will be intoxicated by the false religious system at the end of days. And so even now, we see some Christians, organizations, and groups departing from the biblical truth of the simple gospel, and they're succumbing to progressive social justice a false gospel, it's nice because it's compatible with other religions, and you're not ruffling the feathers of the progressives, but it's all a part of what's coming down upon us like a freight train. Christians should be involved in social justice, but there's a whole movement of progressive social justice which puts basically kind of the scripture over here and puts the political agenda as a priority. We need to be aware of that, and that's one of the reasons we need to pray. Well, look at verse 3 then. He carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, full of blasphemous names, having 7 heads and 10 horns. So this woman, this false religious system, is sitting on a scarlet beast. Now, obviously, it says earlier she's sitting on many waters, which are people. But here, she's taken off in the wilderness. She sees this, John sees this woman sitting upon this scarlet beast full of blasphemous names, having 7 heads and 10 horns. So we saw this beast in Revelation chapter 13, also chapter 12. None other than the beast, the Antichrist himself. And it's associated with the Antichrist. The scarlet color links him with the dragon, who is defined as Satan. So we see behind this religious amalgamation is none other than Satan himself, full of blasphemous names. It reveals his blasphemous character and his deep hatred for Christ and those who follow Christ. Ron Rhodes has written a new book on spiritual warfare, and he describes Satan's hatred for believers, and he said he's totally pulled out the stops in the times that we're living to deceive believers, to neutralize their effectiveness, to tempt them with all kinds of things, to keep them from being on the cutting edge which God wants us to be today. So many distractions. And so it's important that we not allow him to neutralize our effectiveness. So as we use the spiritual weapons that God has given us, they're mighty to the pulling down of strongholds, the scripture says. And so as we apply these weapons, we can live in victory and not succumb to the dictates and be neutralized. Because there's an all-out effort today, and you sense it, you feel it. Shut up. Keep your religion in your church. Don't come out here and tell us about your biblical morality. You just keep this in your church. And you're marginalized. You're deplatformed. I appreciate being on YouTube and Facebook, and we are right now. I don't know how long we'll be on Facebook and YouTube because of the sermons I'm preaching right now. Many pastors have already been deplatformed because they dare speak the truth. We've moved things to Rumble, and we're going to continue to do that. We're very new at technology, and we've got a lot to learn. And we're doing better, but you can pray for our technology that God would help us. Because we're determined to preach the Word of God the way it is, not water it down or candy coat it, but to share just the undiluted, pure Word of God, because that's what helps people. It's not just saying things to get along, to make them feel better in their sin. Listen, Jesus came to die for your sins and my sins. It hurts people. It hurts our families. And so we want to proclaim what God has to say while we have time. And so the neutralization that's going on of Christianity, true biblical Christianity, and not fake Christianity, there's that out there. They're not silencing them, but the truth of the Word of God is being maligned and silenced today. So use those spiritual weapons, and we have 3 mighty spiritual weapons that we repeat over and over again, and that's the wonderful spiritual weapon of praise. Praise is a mighty spiritual weapon. Throughout the Psalms, that's why I encourage people to get into the Psalms and read the Psalms and pray through the Psalms and praise through the Psalms. We have the promises of the Word of God, which are mighty spiritual weapons that keep us from being discouraged. God helps us to get through the pains and the sorrows and the challenges of life as we have the promises of the Lord. And then we have prayer, which is powerful. And I just add one more thing. People, the people of God, our Christian brothers and sisters, are spiritual allies in our spiritual warfare. And we need to lift up Nikki Savage today, who fellowships with us from time to time. She just lost her father a week and a half ago, unexpectedly. Her mother today is in intensive care. They don't expect her to live. So let's pause right now and pray for Nikki. Lord, I can't imagine the pain that Nikki is experiencing. And Father, we would ask that you would have mercy upon Nikki and just touch her mother, Father, and in some way, somehow just speak life into her body. Send forth your word and heal her mother, Lord God. We know that we're asking for a miracle here, but from time to time, Lord God, you perform that miracle. And of course, we pray this under the umbrella of your perfect will because you know best. You know the times of our life. But Father, we just ask that you give Nikki a supernatural peace right now and just surround her with your loving kindness and your grace and the comfort of your Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Spiritual weapons, we need to use them. And we have great weapons that God has given us in this spiritual battle. In one sense, when you see the prophecies of the Scripture being fulfilled, the stage is being set for the fulfillment, it's alarming, yes, but it's also exhilarating because we see, again, the authenticity and the accuracy of His Word, that we can depend upon it. We sing that old song, once in a while, soon and very soon, we're going to see the Lord. Well, that's not just a theoretical song. It could very well be the case. Of course, we don't know when Jesus is coming back for the church. No one knows the day or the hour. But we don't know for sure our time either. And so we want to live out a Christian life as victorious as possible and influence others while we have time. So the beast with 7 heads and 10 horns, we're going to talk about that next week, unpack that. But it's described in several other passages, and 12:3, same thing, another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns. It's like heads and horns. What do they mean? Well, they are significant. And basically, in summary, I'll go into a little bit more detail on this. 10 horns, 10 kings. That's defined for us in the book of Daniel. And the 7 heads represent 7 world kingdoms that we'll see next week. But the woman, the false religious system, is riding this beast who is the Antichrist to power. In other words, the first part of the tribulation is this global religion. And Satan uses this harlot, this false religion, to give rise to the Antichrist, who shows his real true colors the second half of the tribulation. So let's look at verse 4. The woman was clothed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, holding in her hand a cup of abominations and the unclean things of her immorality. This imagery indicates that this false religious system will be wealthy, and have a glorious outer appearance, this religious system is attractively alluring to seduce, just like prostitutes of old and prostitutes today. They seek to be alluring. Why? Their business is prostitution. So they don't want to look like tramps on the side of the road. There's that kind of prostitute, but this is a very alluring, attractive prostitute, and this is a symbolic of the religion that's coming on the scene in the last. It's going to be alluring. It's going to be attractive. It's going to have all the things that really appeal to our eyes and to our senses. But the Lord appeals to our spirit and to our faith. So the gold cup is a picture of something very appealing on the outside, but on the inside, it's full of poison. This false Babylonian religious system will look real good, but it'll wind up killing people spiritually, kill their spiritual relationship with God. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 7 says this in kind of a parallel chapter, and chapter 17, it's basically chapter 18 of Revelation, draws a lot from Jeremiah. But Jeremiah 51, 7 says, Babylon has been a golden cup in the hand of the Lord, intoxicating all the earth. The nations have drunk of her wine. Therefore, the nations are going insane. It's like, you know, when you read this, it shows a couple things. One, this false religious system, people get intoxicated with it, and it drives them mad. But it also shows that this cup is in the hand of the Lord, ultimately. God's in control. As we've seen throughout the book of Revelation, and I've been through the book of Revelation, I think this is my third time teaching through it in my lifetime. And one thing I've gained going through the book of Revelation this time that I didn't really pick up as clearly before was that when the judgments are being poured out, it seems like chaos is happening in our world. The Lord is in control. He only allows what judgment he's designed, he permits. And so that gives us a little hope, a little comfort that, you know, and we've seen as these series of judgments, the trumpets, they come to a conclusion. Right at the end, there's a moment of silence. There's a time of repentance. God gives people time to repent. Same thing with the seals. But by the time you're in the last of the bowl of vile judgments, it's too late. But throughout Revelation, he is so in control. And one of the purposes of these judgments is to wake the world up so that they would come to know him, the true God, be a part of the true religion, if you want to call that. I don't like to call our relationship with him a religion. But God loves people. He loves you. He loves those of you who are listening, and he wants to have that relationship with you. He doesn't want you to just be religious, but he wants you to be right with him because he has great plans for you. And then verse 5 says, and on her forehead a name was written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes and the abominations of the earth. Prostitutes in ancient Rome wore the headband with jewelry and their name on their headband. Here in verse 5, the name on her forehead reveals that this religious Babylon is the greatest and most obscene false religion ever to come upon the world. In fact, it's the source, it's the origin, the mother of all false religions, historically, in the present, and in the future, when this false religion comes on the scene. So this identification takes us all the way back to the Tower of Babel in the book of Genesis, where it all began, on the plains of Shinar in Babylon. And it's like what goes around comes around. And so it began with Nimrod at the Tower of Babel. And there's going to be an organized rebellion against God another time in the tribulation. This is said to be a mystery because this fact had not been revealed in previous times, but it is a mystery now. It's interesting how people interpret that word mystery. Some call it mystical or it's mysterious. But really, it's consistent with all the other times that the word mystery is used in the New Testament several times. And it just means something that wasn't revealed in the Old Testament or in the past, but now, by divine revelation, we can understand what is meant. Verse 6, her persecution. She persecutes those who come against her or disagree with her. Verse 6, and I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the witnesses of Jesus. When I saw her, I wondered greatly. And the angel said to me, why do you wonder? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, and which has the seven heads and the 10 horns. And we'll see this interpretation next week. But right now, this verse says, she was drunk on the blood of God's people. True believers have been martyred for their faith down through the corridors of time in history. But in the tribulation, mass martyrdom will be commonplace. It'll be horrible. This includes the two prophets, the witnesses that we saw in Revelation chapter 11. Some describe as Moses and Elijah. We don't know for sure. They left their calling cards similar. They did similar things to Moses and Elijah, but it doesn't say Moses and Elijah, so we're just not sure. But these two witnesses, these two prophets that are martyred in the middle of the tribulation, and then people see them ascending. But it also includes all those who didn't take the vaccine, excuse me, the mark of the beast. I got to be careful what I say there. We've talked about this. No, the vaccines are not the mark of the beast. But man, when they're saying they become mandatory, and unless you take this vaccine, that you can't do businesses or you can't fly. Now, we're not there yet. Now, Israel is there right now. They've got these green passports. And if you don't have the vaccine, it's tough for you to do anything in Israel right now. It's like, oh my goodness. Well, coming to a community near you. Do you really think, those of you who have received the vaccines, and bless you if you've done that. We're praying, you know, for you. Some are taking it, some are not taking it. I think that's a freedom of choice, what you stick into your body. I think we still have that freedom, but it's fading away quick, like our Constitution is like, well, there it is. It's kind of a figure, but who's obeying the Constitution now? It's kind of like the Scripture. God has given us certain principles in the Word of God, and who this is old-fashioned. We don't need this. I mean, this is a new generation. I mean, men can use women's bathrooms now if they say they're a woman. You know, this is the generation. Can you believe we're living in that? Can you believe this? 10 years ago, 15 years ago, it's like, my goodness, things are changing. And it's like the frog being boiled in a pot of water slowly. You've heard the illustration. If you put a frog or a toad in the water and slowly bring it to a boiling point, they'll stay there and boil to death. But if it's quick, you know, they're going to jump out quick. We are slowly accepting things we've never accepted before. But Jesus said, be aware, do not be deceived. These are things that are happening now that Jesus forecast, Paul forecast, and the ancient Hebrew prophets forecast millennia ago. Oh, we see this coming. It's on us. It's on us? Yes. Wake up. So, vaccines. Anyway, what I started to say, you think those of you who received the vaccine, you're done? Don't kid yourself. There's boosters coming out. I would say, because of mutations or alleged mutations that's coming with this virus and others coming down the pike, it's going to be an annual thing or a semi-annual thing or a regular basis, just like the annual flu shot. It's going to be the same thing with these vaccines. You think you're done with just two vaccines or one vaccine, depending on? No. And if you don't take them, the pressure's going to be on. So, no, the vaccines are not the mark of the beast, but we can see how the stage is being set for the ultimate fulfillment of that. It's not the mark of the beast because the beast is not here yet. The beast has got to be on the scene before you take the mark of the beast. And before the beast comes on the scene, the good news is the church is not going to be here. Because the Bible talks about a major evacuation that's coming of his church. Now, I know not everybody believes that the church is going to be raptured. They call it escape theology. I say, hey, man, I want to escape this stuff that's coming. We've been going through Revelation. We see the judgments are coming. I wouldn't wish that on anybody. That's why I want to share the word with people. I want to see people come to Christ who took the wrath of God for us. The tribulation is a period of wrath where God's wrath is being poured out. Jesus took the wrath of God for us. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 1:10, who delivers us from the wrath to come, the coming wrath. Christ delivers us from that. Talking about the wrath of the tribulation. Several passages that indicate that. Well, she was drunk on the blood of God's holy people during the tribulation. It's going to be horrible. I was in a discussion, a Facebook discussion. I don't debate on Facebook. I use my Facebook for edification, encouragement, pictures of the family, and that sort of thing. So if someone wants to get into a heated discussion, we'll go to a message. And so it didn't get to that point. We just kind of sharing back and forth. But the topic was, religion has done more to harm people and kill people than any other thing on the planet. And so basically, I would say, well, religion, yes. True Christianity, no. And so that led to further discussions. You know, atheistic communism is really a religion. And they're responsible for the deaths of probably over 100 million people. Communism. 100 million people. That's more than, quote, religion in the traditional sense goes. But, you know, you'd have to put atheistic communism under the guise or under the banner of a religion. And yeah, but what about the Crusades? You know, Christians went down there and they slaughtered the Muslims. And yeah, they did that in the name of Christ to liberate Jerusalem. And there are actually four Crusades and maybe even a fifth one. You know what? Those Crusaders who did that, who were supposed Christians, I call them fake Christians, because where did Jesus say to slaughter your enemies? Islam says that. Christianity doesn't say that. Christianity says to love your enemies. And so, you know, if they were Christians, they were disobedient Christians. And I would say back then, most of them were fake Christians. They were under a false sense of religiosity. not true born-again believers. But, you know, you look at the religion of atheism today. Remember, Jesus said, do not be deceived. The Marxist ideology leads to full-blown communism. And that's what many of our politicians are espousing today. That's what the media is just parroting constantly, Marxism. And oh, Black Lives Matter. Did you know? Yes, Black Lives certainly matter. But did you know the founders of Black Lives Matter were committed Marxists? And what do you see? Do you see riots and demonstrations? And, you know, again, of course, we have to separate the love that we have for our Black brothers and sisters, the love that Jesus has for them. Their lives are precious. They certainly do matter. But the organization of Black Lives Matter is a communist organization. And these corporations are giving millions and millions to this. You see what I mean about potentially being deplatformed? Well, let me draw this to a conclusion here. There's some contrast between the false church and the true church. First of all, the false church is called a vile prostitute in Revelation chapter 17. And the true church is pictured as a pure virgin bride, a pure bride in Revelation chapter 21, 22. The harlot is in the wilderness, the bride is in heaven. By this time, we're talking about the church is in heaven by this time, true church. The harlot is adorned by Satan, 17:4, while the bride is adorned by Christ, 19:8, fine linen, bright and clean. The harlot church is judged forever. The bride of Christ reigns forever. The harlot is stained with the blood of the martyrs. The bride is redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I choose the Lamb of God. I choose true biblical faith in Christ, not just. Well, we had Dr. Erwin Lutzer speak here a couple of weeks ago. He's such a blessing. And his book, I recommend it if you haven't had a chance to get it. We're out of it. We sold out of it. We don't sell things. We take donations. But we don't have any more copies. We're going to order some more this week. But you can order it, you know, on Amazon and different places. He's got so much to say in here. In fact, Dr. David Jeremiah says, if I could, I would put this book in the hands of every Christian in America. He says this, page 34, 35. He says, and this is entitled The Silent Church. He says, it's time for the church to step up to the plate and seize the moral high ground. Those of us who have been witnesses to the rapid transformation of our country, we who are members of the church, have been strangely silent. And with good reason. To our shame, we are afraid of the secular left. We fear being misquoted by the press, vilified by special interest groups, and threatened by the radicals. There is no joy in being called a racist, hateful, bigoted, homophobic, or accused of imposing our religious views on others. Then he goes to say, I write this book with a heavy heart. Never before have I felt so much like Jehoshaphat, who called a fast when several vicious armies united and came against Israel. He prayed a desperate prayer of repentance, pleading with God and saying, we are powerless against this great horde that is coming against us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 12. But then the choir began to sing praise to God, and the victory was won. clearly, the sovereign God who knows all things and plans all things has prepared us for this moment. We are more ready than we realize to represent Christ in our fragmenting culture. We might not know exactly what to do, but we can say along with Jehoshaphat, our eyes are upon you. Father, we can, it's such a privilege to be alive at this point in history where we're seeing so many things happen. Lord, we shouldn't be surprised because you foretold a long time ago the very time that we'd be entering into. And so now is the time for Christians to get off the fence and not be playing Christianity, but to take you very seriously and to apply your word to their lives, to our lives, and look to you as Jehoshaphat did, as Dr. Lutzer exhorted us to do. Who knows? Who knows? Maybe you'll turn things around. You could do that. And we pray for revival and awakening, and we continually intercede for that. But Father, until and unless that happens, we want to be found faithful until you take us home as a body of believers or you take us home individually when our time is fulfilled. We want to be found faithful, Lord God. So Lord, thank you for cleansing us and forgiving us and casting our sins from the east, from the west. Thank you for empowering us with your Spirit to do what needs to be done. And we go forth in faith today, Lord God, knowing that you're with us, that you haven't abandoned your church. And if we have to suffer some persecution, so what? You're going to be there with us. You give us grace when it comes to suffering. That's in our wish. That's in our desire. We pray that doesn't happen. But we want your will more than we want our will, Lord God. And we come to you with praise and adoration, knowing that you're so in control. That gives us peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Those of you who are listening by YouTube, if you don't know the Lord, we just ask you to come to know him. He died for your sins, purchased that pardon for you on the cross for forgiveness and eternal life. And if you would ask him to come into your life, make you the kind of person that he wants you to be, he will do that. Now, we don't come to Christ through prayer. We come to Christ by faith and believing what he's written in his word. But prayer is an expression of our faith. So if you prayed a prayer like that, then welcome to God's forever family. You just become part of the solution instead of part of the problem. So onward, Christian soldiers. Have a wonderful week. If you can get to one of our studies and fellowships during the week, join us. Bless you.